year is 2003. David Morgan learns to program at university. Then he spends the next 20 years teaching students how to code in different ways. His understanding of modern programming paradigms gets worse and worse. Now it's 20 years later, and David works for Replit. Can he upskill in time to meet the needs of the 21st century?
And welcome to Old Code and New Tricks, where I'm being taught something new every 2 weeks or so. I'm joined today by Anirban. Hello.
Hello there.
Who's very excitedly to be teaching me, and I think I'm right in saying this, you said you tried to compress 2 years worth of data science knowledge into 1 hour. Oh. So I'm very excited to get started.
Okay, so I have been waiting for this moment for a long time because I have learned a lot from you from the 100 days of Python course that you have done. And this was my opportunity to share a little bit with you, something that I have been learning. So what we are going to talk and learn about today is data science. So what does data science mean? So
science... I've got a basic understanding of what it is, but like, let's go for the formal definition. Blow my mind.
Yes. Well, it's not a full-blown definition, but I would rather suggest a more practical definition, something that you can think about, that you can work on, because a memorized, regurgitated definition can be, you know, taught to anybody or learned by anybody, but a working definition would help you think more, to be more creative and more so in the age of ChatGPT, right? So, data is any measurement. So, data comes from, I think, 1600s, there was the first usage of the term, and it means any fact. It doesn't have to be correct. It just have to be a measured fact. For example, if I measure my height, okay. So, because I'm measuring myself by a ruler probably, so I may be wrong. So there we use an error percentage. So that is an advanced form of data, but basic data is that I have tried to measure myself. So that is data. So what is data science? Now we must go to the next part of it, science. So what is science? Yes, you're recording data.
Well, I thought that was interesting because you talk about height, right? I've been saying to everyone that I'm 181 centimeters, the best part of, I don't know, 30 years, but it occurred to me the other day when I was at the doctor's and getting measured that I haven't actually taken my height since I had hair. So I'm not quite 181 centimeters because there's a bit missing from up here.
Well, I may add a simple trick to you. If you sleep, your height will increase by 2.5 centimeters.
Oh,
it's exactly. So it's a physics trick. It was properly learned first when people were sent to the, you know, outer space. So their heights would increase in the spaceship or in their spacesuit. So they would feel a little bit, you know, problematic because, and then a full-blown research was done and they found that when you sleep, because there is no gravity, you increase a bit of height. So let's come back to data science again. So what is science? So this is where science comes in. Direct questioning of the data, that what is the data, where did we get it, why did we get it, how did we get it, when did we get it, because data drifts. There is a popular term called data drift, and there is also a similar term called model drift. So what is data drift? So let's say in sports, because the rules of the games change, the data that is generated by the players on the competition, for example, you know cricket, right? Okay, so let's say football. It's football or soccer for US citizens.
Any sport I can claim on, but you go for it.
Okay, let's say in some parts of the age, let's say in 1900s, there was a more inclination towards a good defense rather than a good offense. But probably as the viewerships grew, there was a more inclination towards more offense. And the team that just did more goals, and even though it may have gotten a little setbacks by the other team because of a worse defense than it would have had previously. So the model, so the data has changed. So the data which was necessary for the entertainment of the people, let's say, a good defense. People would appreciate good defense. That how did you, you know, do it? What was the practice behind the scenes? But now you will ask, how, what did you practice to do that goal, do that penalty shootout? What did you do to calm yourself during that, after the, you know, midfield? So these are the different questions that one can do on the data that we have got our hands on. So today I aim to discuss something like that. I aim to see the data for what it has been given to us and think about it a little bit. I am going to use different notebooks and try to see what different people have done. The most entertaining part of data science is that different people have different perspectives and they show it to you. And they do not judge. They just show it, show the data for what it is. At least the what data has been collected. There is a problem even in, you know, collection of data, because there have been different agents who have got the permission or who have got the allowance to be, you know, in the position to collect data. So let's start. So that is the definition. Let me summarize the definition again. So data science, meaning questioning the data or the facts that are presented to you in order to understand and predict. So that is a basic definition for me. And now let's do a little bit of history of data science. I do not have a presentation prepared, but the things that I'm going to explain have been very easily found on the internet, and I was a little bit busy for the internship, so I apologize for that. But it starts
slide deck. Don't worry, we did it all singing, all dancing slide deck. Sometimes it's just good enough to talk about it.
Yes, I appreciate. Thank you. So it started with the U.S. trying to build a census data for its own population because of the different, you know, migration policies and different business reasons and government reasons, because they wanted to understand more about the population that they were governing and preparing the business for. So the first time they did, I think it was 1890s. So they made the 1890s census data for 8 to 9 years. But the 1890s data was available only after 1898. So there was a huge time gap in and the energy required to just collect the data. So after that, they said we have to enhance it and make it better. So they tried again. This time they used a little bit of machinery. They used paper coding scripting machine, like we make bash scripts or Python scripts. They had a paper script. There were holes in them. And they would say that if there is a hole, it means he has a house or he doesn't have a house. It was similar like 0 and 1. And that data set took 13 years. So it took more than a decade to collect it. And this, all of these were done by different companies, different tenders, and different people. So IBM's formation was a direct response to this. So international business machines were created for this reason, to be able to collect data and to process data and to generate a data analysis for the US government in an easy way. and to standardize the practice. So even though we may think data science has existed from 2008 or 2010, and like from internet began after that probably, but that is not really true because it has very old roots. And I am just talking about the mechanical history of it. Probably Abacus is the first example of a data analysis machine, because even though children may think we ask them to do mathematics just for the sake of it, but there are proper reasons which we do not teach, at least until this point before ChatGPT. So they used to use the Abacus, which has, I am also very fascinated with Abacus because it is so simple. It is so clear. And there is a problem of volatility, because if you shake the Abacus, everything goes out and you have to redo the data, all the additions.
Original Abacus,
yeah. Yes, we are still working on that, persistent data systems. So, so this is the history. And another thing, another brilliant company that we all are proud of and love is Apple. One of the greatest reasons for Apple's, you know, mass appropriation and acceptance was a VisiCalc software, which they made, which was particularly for data analysis and data preparation, and to just simply tabulate paper data and to work easily. So, so we know Apple for design, but there was this piece of software which was particularly interesting. And of course, after that, Microsoft did the Excel, and everybody's work involved Excel and just learning about it and the different formulas.
As a teacher, the vast majority of me showing off to other teachers was just being able to use Excel. They didn't care that I could program in multiple different languages. They were impressed with the fact that I could reference one sheet from another.
So even for me also, when I was in school, I joked to my friends that the only skill that I learned from school that directly benefits me in work is data science, because there was a teacher of mine who would ask me to do the complete school data analysis, like every class, how many people, you know, got passed, how many people got the top ranks. And I don't know, I used to love it there also. I'm little difficult in model. I feel a difficulty in modeling, but so that was my start also. So just Excel, just doing. So different teachers would come to me and ask me, how did I just formulate it? So this was the history of data science up to probably 1980s with the Apple doing the VisiCalc. And after 1990s, everybody knows the game, the internet boom just tried to download the whole of the world into the internet, into a binary form, into just textual data, and we are reaping its benefits. Actually, while doing the research for this, you know, talk, I'm still at an introductory level. I'm learning, but I'm still not an expert. So one of the interesting things I found about is that there was a fifth paradigm of science that Microsoft is actually funding and working about. It's called plenary. So it, like we say, standing on the shoulder of the giant. So it stands on the shoulders of data science. So data science was the fourth paradigm of science and computation. And in the plenary, what we do is that directly do the computation simulations and use our real data onto it and try to make the simulation better. So there is an unprecedented amount of development that is still about to happen. And there is one key insight that I found, is that the synthetic data use. We often talk about ChatGPT and how it is so useful in explaining the text and the predictions, the next word prediction and the context prediction. But I think the OG was the computer-generated random numbers or the computer-generated prime numbers, at least the approximation of it, approximation of the pseudo random numbers or the pseudo-prime numbers. So I think that we never talk about them. Even though we talk about data and data science, they actually started the game that if human beings can generate a number without any thought, just whatever comes to their mind, and a computer can also do that, why are we not calling it similar or some form of intelligence? So that was in academic space, and now we are actually using that. And yes, so another point that I want to make is that of synthetic intelligence. There is a problem, not a problem, just a way of understanding it is difficult, what artificial intelligence, which is a direct correlation to data science. So in synthetic intelligence, we directly talk about the data and the synthesized computation and the synthesized information that we glean from it. We do not, in the artificial intelligence, the sense is different. It's as if the data doesn't exist, as if the information doesn't exist. It exists. It's just that human beings would take a lot of time, and computer just synthesizes it a very fast rate and easily. So that was the history of data science, at least from my side. And today what we are going to do in practical terms is explore the Kaggle website. And Kaggle is known as the home of data science. So I would ask you to just open your web browser and go to kaggle.com.
Okay. Do you want me to share your screen or should I share mine?
You can share yours. I will share it when I'm presenting my presentation. So the thing about kaggle.com is everything, yeah, you can just register for it. Yeah, it's a one click, yeah. So the thing about kaggle.com is you can do any sorts of data science activities in it. And those includes competitions and exploring data sets. Oh yes, this is the famous Kaggle home page. And if you can go to that, there is a duck symbol on the right side of the screen. On the right, absolute right.
Oh, sorry. This one.
Yeah. No, absolute right side. On. Yeah. So here you can see David at Replit. So what is Kaggle? Kaggle is a site where you can do data science activities like you see on the left hand side, you can create, if you can click on create. Yeah, you can see new notebook, new data set, new competition. You can even create your own competition based on your own data. And then there are the same.
It's also for competitive coding, isn't it? That's right. Is that right?
It's not, I wouldn't say it competitive coding. It's a kind of competitive, it's a competitive website, but we do modeling. We do data set predictions, like in like code forces or data structure and algorithms, where the coding competition is directly based on the data structures that you are using and the algorithms that you are using to enforce efficiency of the memory or efficiency of time. In Kaggle, what we do is create the efficiency of models based on the parameters that are set by the competition host. For example, if they say accuracy, so what do we mean by accuracy? It means the number of predictions. For example, my height is also 180 centimeter. And from your description, I learned that your height is 181 centimeter. So let's say
I'm 79.
So I can create a competition here where I would put the data of simple that David's height is this and my height is this. And let's build a model which will predict this outcome. So whoever's model predicts that my height is 180 and your height is 181, we will get the full accuracy because he will get two out of two, both of the data points. But let's say I make a model, but that only gets my data point because I know myself. I do not know you physically. So I will get 1/2. So that will be 50% accuracy. So those are the competitions. It's not a data structure and algorithms competition, but a good understanding of DSA would be really helpful, because you can make the machine learning algorithms a little bit faster. You can manipulate the data structures differently. One thing is that the way of thinking, the intuitive way of thinking about data structures and algorithms is different from the coding competition, the competitions on Kaggle, because here the data structures are a huge data sets. For example, let me share my screen.
Yours up, hold on. There you go.
Ooh, yes.
Window.
So this is my homepage. You can see it is welcoming me, and there is a login state, my progress towards expert progression system, my public activity, and different metrics of it. And there is how to start on Kaggle. There are courses, there are data sets, and different things. So what I wanted to show was that a competition that I'm currently doing, it is called the Vesuvius Challenge. Yes.
Oh, so what is this one?
Sorry?
So I think I've heard of this one, but go on, tell us about it.
Okay. So this is an extremely interesting competition, and it has a huge prize money, as you can see, which is a lot of the reasons for people participating like hellishly here. So the challenge is, there is a scroll, as you can see here. This has been unearthed by the archaeologists. So there, and this is a middle-age scroll, and there are different thoughts in there, process we do not know actually. So that is why in the Kaggle competition, we are trying to detect the ink inside it. So we are doing different scannings and different methods on hardware level, and converting them into the digital manner, and then using the machine learning method to detect the ink, and then use another machine learning algorithm to detect what is written and what we can actually predict with a high accuracy.
Am I right? Part of the difficulty of this is not only that it is ink on layers of paper, but because they're rolled up, we also have to essentially somehow roll it in the computer's memory.
Of course, you are very right. But the most important part of Kaggle competition is that a lot of the work has been done for you, and that is why it is a learning platform. Like, you do not have to work for the data, you do not have to work for the baseline model, for the EDA. A lot is going to be done for you. What you have to do is parameterize. And don't get me wrong, this is a quite advanced competition, and it's very, very difficult. But it is still, an opportunity, an open playing ground. It's not, you will never be asked in Kaggle to show your credentials or anything. You just have to show your curiosity and passion and just the will to learn. So this is, even though the complete prize money is $1 million, it is, this competition is for $100,000. It has been doubled since, I think, last 2 weeks, just to increase participation and everything. So you are completely right that this is, because it is unearthed from ground, there is a layer of mud around it. There are different obstacles inside it, which the aim of the commission is to be able to detect, go past through those difficulties and find a good example, like these, like the photo fragments that you can see. And these are aligned in infrared photo, the hand level binary mask. These are different term, which just means, these are just filters like we do on Instagram, just a different kind. So another thing is that, just the way we talked about the competition in DSA, that you have to show the efficiency, there are two kinds of competitions on Kaggle. This is a code competition, which means you have to share the code that you are using to build this model to predict the ink used in creating these writings, the yeah, the glyphs. And there is a timeline, evaluation prizes, code discussion teams. I am participating with a team here. Let me show you myself. Yeah, my team is called Voyagers because we are just journeying through this world of data science. So this is my team. I am with another friend called Margaret. So a second, yeah. The Kaggle progression system. So in this Kaggle competition, you can also do good and you can rank here. For example, the first team that is part of is called Fat GPT. So he means that he is using different kinds of, you know, GPT manipulations to just participate here, and he has the best score here. And there's a postcode DX, and these golden symbols mean if he ends in the gold medal position until the end of the competition, he will get a ranking in the Kaggle system, and you will have, let me show you. Yes, the Kaggle progression system. So you can see that this is changing, and similarly, there is different tiers: novice, contributor, expert, master, and grandmaster. So I am at contributor level. So if I do well in competition, data sets, and networks, and discussion, and keep in mind that these all have to be in competitions that are eligible for the ranking. I have participated in many community competitions, so I am not really eligible for the ranking. Yes. So so let me go through different parts of the Kaggle website. Like you saw, this is the profile of mine. And here you can see the discussions I have made, the notebooks I have contributed, the data sets I have contributed. There is a private data set, but this is only for public. And these are the competitions that I have been part of. And there is a bio, you can share anything you want. And this is the competition part, like I shown you. I showed you mine, which is a featured competition, which is eligible for rankings and prizes. But there are different kinds of competitions too, like for research, which is the research competitions are also applicable for ranking, but maybe a little less of a price, but still pretty cool. There's a playground for beginners. I have participated in playgrounds a lot. There's a community which are created by, for example, the competition exam I just gave you. Like if it is created by an individual or a friend of yours just for fun. And these are analytics, which is a code competition, which is needs the EDA, the exploratory data analysis that you do on it. The data sets.
So what was interesting to me is how varied the applications of data science are, because I'd heard of that Vesuvius competition from other means. I had no idea that the way you tackled it was through data science, and there's just so many different applications of it. It's such a big, no wonder you had difficulty compressing 2 years into an hour. It's such a broad field.
While you said 2 years, I remembered. So this is the web. This is one of the website. So if you want to do a local hosting, you have to do. Let me do show it on the terminal. Can you see the terminal, David?
All good.
Yeah. Okay. So there is a code section. So in here, you can make your own notebooks. So you can see people have done COVID-19. This is not clear. Wine quality, EDA for heart disease predictions, and Kaggle provides its own.
Sounds like it will be worthwhile.
Sorry?
I said the wine quality predictor looks like it will be a good.
Of course. Data. The perfect afternoon is a bottle of wine, a glass of wine, Kaggle, and it just good.
Wine.
But I would like to mention a cone of Kaggle, which is actually solved by Replit, the site we use for hackathons and different kinds of things. It's that you can only explore things on Kaggle. You cannot run a full-blown website or a model on it. It will just time out after 12 hours. But if you want to do host a website or a model, you can use Kaggle. There are Flask servers and different methods on it. So that is that. And the thing I was trying to show you was that there is a notebook you can do. If I just click on new notebook, you can see a whole notebook has been created for me. And this is awesome because it has huge capacity. It has 110 gigabytes of storage. And let me share another thing about data sets. The data sets are huge. For example, the Vesuvius data set, the complete data set, is about 1.4 terabytes.
What? Oh. Unbelievable. That's crazy.
The data set that I am working on the Kaggle website is of 37 gigabytes. And they encourage to, you know, use their other data sets. You can use different data sets. You do not have to only use the data set that they provide. So it's crazy. The amount of, you know, the range that a data science competition or a model or a project can go. It's brilliant and it's just fun. So about the notebooks.
When I taught a smattering of this is what data science is to 18-year-olds for a while, my example was always I collected every lyric to every top 100 song for the past 50 years. And they had to make me interesting graphs and trends and predictions and things from that. And that data set was about 6 megabytes. So I like the sizes you're talking about are ridiculous.
Yes, I have also done a 100 most searched Spotify songs. And I understand where you're coming from. I was baffled too. I tried to avoid data science for a long time because of the huge volumes of data sets. But I found out some resources which I'm like right now sharing with you, which I think people would be really helpful because it's difficult to store such a huge data set and work on your own local machine without any support. So, yeah. So Kaggling, and I also hear Replit is increasing their data storage capacity using some Google databases. So Kaggle is also going to be able to store a ridiculous amount of data for, you know.
I think it's out to explore. It's certainly out to beta test at the minute of our Infinity Drive, which is going to be our more storage options. So yeah, very soon, if you want to host these ridiculous models on Replit, it'll be a possibility.
So as you can see in the notebook, there is NumPy. This is a library in Python. There's a pandas, and many people, even I, used to confuse pandas with the actual animal pandas. But and here is the famous OS library, and you can just sort out the directories inside it. You can use it for data. And here I wanted to show the evolution. So first we started with IPython. This is an interactive Python console, but it is different from the regular Python that you will get. For example, if I just type Python, here the facilities that you will get, like code completion and not code completion, just like the keyword completion and things like that, or the history. In the previous this command line function, you can do different things like visualize the data that you are seeing, like using pandas, and show the graphs using tkinter, and different sorts of things. Then there are different magic functions like, yeah, this is matplotlib inline. There are different other, this is a specialty of the IPython functionality. here you can, another important thing is time. So time for, yeah. You can see how much time it took just to run the one single command on my CPU time. So there are different things. And from here, what evolved was Jupyter Notebook. And it creates a server on this local machine, which you can use to, yeah. This shows everything on my computer, and there are notebooks inside it. For example, is a practice notebook. And this is the way you can, you know, do machine learning or just notebooks on your host machine. And this is the example. There is a, this was a machine learning joke that I was trying to do based on the data set. For example, I asked you about the height, right? So here I created a synthetic data set of age and height using NumPy a range function. So here you can see at zero, I just arbitrarily chose the different heights. At zero age, you have 75 centimeters, 79 and 4. But what the funny thing about it is that as the as we go towards modeling, if we base our model on this data set, what we see is a direct line. As if as we grow 100 years of age, you will get a 500 centimeters of height. So this is so this is not possible, right?
Might be true. You never know.
Yes.
My granddad wasn't a tall man, but maybe he started off very small. You never know.
Yes. So this was a, I was trying to make a, you know, YouTube video based on the funny things about data science and the predictions it can make on the just wrong data that it has been fed. For example, I wouldn't be wrong if I just put the age as 1.5. It would have given me the correct height based on the data. But because the data set is not complete, and this is a interesting, you know, point in data science, the availability of the data or the bias of the data or the predictions that we do on the data. Because if there is a famous quote that if we torture the data for long enough, it will concede to anything that we ask. So
I think Maggie's already said that in the chat as well.
Yes. So this is an extremely, you know, interesting example. So I just wanted to show you different ways, you know, you can just do it. And yes, this is the notebook.
I'm interested in terms of like inferring meaning and finding biases like that. How do large language models plug into like looking at this data output? Has any work been done on that yet?
Oh no! The work has been ongoing, but it is very difficult to fine tune a large language model because you have to retrain it times and times based on the example I just shown you. Because if the data that you are working on is of not the appropriate quality, it will be very difficult for it to, you know, just fine tune over it.
It's gonna have a trouble. Yeah, I've got it.
So there is one thing that I forgot while explaining the history of data science is that the data science at first was extremely rule based. What I mean by that is that every analysis or every understanding that you did was based on the rules that has been gleaned by the human expert, the subject matter experts. For example, the census data, for example, the ability of an individual. There is a famous data set of, let me show you, UCI. Yes, census data set. For example, here, it's a, this is also a famous site to get, you know, data sets of smaller sizes. So here also, we try to predict if an individual will have greater than or less than $50,000 in their annual income based on the previous Yes, 1994 and 1995. Sorry, I forgot the flow. Can you repeat the question again, David? Bias, right?
So how do we detect that bias? That was the question, really.
Yeah. So because the data is different, because during this period, there were different kinds of the inflation was different, just the housing system was different, the policy was different, the education was different, the adjusted gross income was different. The prediction that it will make based on this would be different if I use it right now. So this is where the concept of data drift is coming from, where you cannot deal with improper data to, you know, just get the absolutely good predictions. You have to use current data, and this is where the synthetic data generation or the synthetic data analysis is coming from. It is like predicted by 2025, the amount of synthetic data would exceed the human data by 70%. I am just balling the numbers right now, but there is a significant increase. I may not be absolutely precise about the numbers, but that is the problem. Because you see, for example, I share my data to a bank. It has all my sensitive data, and it is currently, even though it's masking my personal data and using it for different things, it is still kind of using a derivative based on my information. So in the synthetic data, everything will be a similarity of data. For example, they will just use the features needed. They would extrapolate data based on that. They will, so that they can use the neural network hungry models to just train it on as much data as needed, not relying on the human population and the ethics that are regarding it, just to circumvent that problem. So there is that. So I was trying to show you the notebooks here. So this is a notebook setup that you can do. And as you can see, there are Kitty and Corgi. Yeah, Corgi is going away. So this is the cutest feature I find on Kaggle. Here you can rename it. So, and you can also add this. For the longest period of time, I did not know how do these things come on. But you can do this using the view and toggle Corgi mode and Kitty mode. And
I love the fact that's in the drop-down menu. That's like a high-level function.
Oh, you know, working on this, I have been working on these notebooks for a long time, and it really helps to see some pets run around. I would appreciate some music also, you know. With the MuseNet of OpenAI, I can really use some auto-generated music. I currently use Free Code Camp Code Radio, but yeah. So this is a basic, you know, notebook. Here you can see the file, and you can link to GitHub. You can save version. You can also share. If I share here, I can share it as private. I can share it as private, and I can use Collaborate. For example, David, you just joined. You can see here. So I can just add you to say, you know, view this notebook while others cannot. It is not a public, and allow for comments. Or I can add the permission as can edit. So you can even edit my notebook while I'm doing it. And if I save it, it will just send you an email. And if I do public, I will just showcase it to the world. I will share with you a notebook that I have made. That is Kaggle, that is for presentation purposes. Yes. So after, you know, going through that notebook, the final outcome is this. So this is where you see the notebook option. Here is the input that it is showing, the sample submission, the test CSV, the train CSV. And David, if anything just, you know, seems different or new to you, just ask me. I will be happy to explain. A lot of things I understood that I have been, you know, accustomed because I have been doing it for so long. Like just the example of Jupyter notebook. I understand it is the not the normal, you know, way people do Python programming or just exploration.
It's so good. It's worth mentioning for anybody that's tuned in and sort of is scratching their head there. Notebooks are great in data science because they allow you to do one step at a time and just execute and iterate on that one data set you've got. Whereas a running program will need to load it into memory and go through those steps each and every time. So it's a slightly more refined way of doing something like data science. It doesn't really work if you're... I know I had a lot of teacher friends that tried to use them to teach how to program. And like personally, I don't think that works very well. I think something like Replit works a lot better for actual hardcore programming. It's, you know, we do have a Jupyter notebook template on Replit. I haven't used it myself because I don't do a lot of data science stuff. But we've got this stuff there as well.
Yeah, no, I have actually used the Kaggle version, the Replit version. And it is very useful. And I have also tried, there are little inconsistencies, but and because Kaggle has provided so much facilities, including the corgi and the kitty, it's just, you know, a more desirable thing for exploration.
It's a defining factor, I see.
Yes, you can call them one of my close friends. So, but yes, you can do anything on anything that you do in the coding world, you can do on Replit. And I would try to explain something. I have explained it on a Medium EDN, yes. So this is a blog post that I wrote. So EDN notebook versus model notebook, exactly the problem that you mentioned. So we have EDN notebooks where the purposes, techniques, and analysis and outcomes are defined, where you just explore the data set. So the Kaggle notebook that you saw, it is only for exploration purposes, not for full-blown creating a website or experimentation, because it is extremely easy to mess things up and get confused about it. So here is the EDA notebook where you will explain the data. For example, I shown you the data set problem in the height I created, the synthetic height data I created. It is incomplete. So if you do the EDA, and because you are a human being, you will know that people don't stop, you know, at age 5 or age 10. People just age until 100, and there is a like a log curve where you just stop increasing your height and you just settle on the height for life. So
you go bald, like me.
No. I would say your baldness seems... You are my favorite bald teacher and favorite bald, you know, presenter. I
appreciate that.
I will give anything else. I will give up, you know, hairy teachers for you. So here is the model EDA notebook and here is the model notebook. So model notebooks are helpful if you are just experimenting with the model on small things. But for the final thing, you need a model script. For example, you do coding on, you know, general Python files and things for the final deployment, for the final applications. So notebooks are essentially for experimentation with different parameters and hyperparameters. And what I mean by parameters is just the mean, mode, median of the data that you are getting. For example, the mean, mode, median of the data that I just generated in the height, there is a minimum value of 75. There is a maximum value. There is a mean value of all the data that I have generated. And there is a curve that is generating. So this is the model notebook. There are data acquisition and pre-processing notebook, feature engineering, model interpretation, model deployment. I'm sorry if I'm just throwing words at you. Because there is, you know, just the basics of data science is so vast, so much vast. It's
yeah, I really underestimate how big it is, honestly. You know, I mean, one of the things I always say is when we're giving presentations is throw as much out there as possible, because if somebody's interested, they'll latch onto those words and they'll go and research it themselves. But do go and dig into this. It's a really fascinating area of the general computer science world.
Yes, and I have also shared some of the thinkings about the machine learning and philosophy, and you know, different, just my amusement. I do not really intend it for public view. I just keep it like a journal, and if it helps somebody else. So I have discussed different things, and there are EDA, and there are data pre-processing and data structuring algorithms, different things. So I will keep it at that. And yes, to the presentation notebook again. Let me see that time. Okay. I will have to go a little bit faster. I think I promised you the I promised you to, you know, participate in a Kaggle competition. I thought I would be done by now. Let me just try.
Everyone that's done one of these with me has got to this point to go, oh, I've just been talking for a while. But it's part of the introduction, isn't it? It's, you know, I know very little about these things. It's great to have this introduction and this basis. So everything's been great so far. What can you fit into 3 minutes for us? Go on.
Okay, so I wanted to show you the presentation that I did. For example, I shown you the UCI website where your task is to binary classify. What I mean by binary classification is just that, you know, predict whether somebody will get more than $50,000 or less than $50,000 per year. And these are the famous libraries of data science: Pandas, NumPy, Matplotlib, Plotly, Seaborn, and things like that. What their pandas do, it is actually coming from the word panel data. What panel data used to do is just tabulate things. For example, another trivia is that, do you know what the tab on your keyboard does?
I think I do, but you might tell me differently. I think it... indents,
yes. While we do coding, we think that yes.
I thought it might be a trick question.
No. I am also naive like you. I also thought it was just for, you know, that the famous wall of tabs versus spaces. I just used to think it is for, you know, easy purposes, just easy indentation. But what I understand from a teacher of mine, he told me that it's for tabulation. For example, my screen, notebook is visible to you, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So tab is a short form of tabulate. For example, I write Anirban, I tab, then I give the separator. Then I write David, then I tab, then I give the separator, then I write replet. So let's say these are the different heads of the table. So this is just easy tabulation. Or else you have to, you know, just press spacebar 4 times or, you know, unknown number of times. Then you press enter and then you just do, you know, just the separator, then you come again. So let's say it is the height.
Back to markdown tables now.
Yeah. Markdown, yeah. Oh, I completely missed. In the notebook, you can do markdown also. And it is a primary use case also. Like, you can use language for scripting, Python or R language for data analysis and scripting. And use markdown for just, you know, explanation of what you are doing instead of commenting using code. So this is an example of it. Yes. So the writings that you see in the problem understanding, loading required libraries, these are all done in markdown. So you have to just learn the basics of markdown also to be able to, you know, participate here.
I mean, that's why, yes, that's why notebook format is quite good though, isn't it? It's because you can explain what you're doing as you're going along. Whereas,
yes,
normal code is much more the notes are there for you to help fix it or change things later on. They're not really talking through your process. Whereas in data science, it's presumably more useful to need to talk about how you did it so you can replicate results elsewhere.
Yeah, for example, this bio, this is of exact similar nature to GitHub bio. So interesting thing about Markdown is that you can just add direct images from, you know, websites. For example, I created this image using stable diffusion of, you know, Bing image generator. I used the prompt, how to change the world with code. And it gave an interesting image. I thought, you know, I would use it. So this is Markdown. And I just wrote something in, you know, bold and italics. And so there, you know, there are multiple things and there are so much to learn. I would be happy to do, you know, many sessions with you, David, if you like. But I have to do a, you know, lengthy.
I have to do one practical one, I think. You need to show me some code and get something moving around. So we'll get that in the books for later on, I think. But I'm going to have to say thank you very much for this session. I feel like I've learned loads. I can feel my already big head growing the amount of information that has got in. Thank you so much. We'll try and get another one if you're happy to do another one on the calendars. You can show me some practical data science as well, because that would be amazing. Do you want to plug anything or send anybody anywhere? I've put a link to your Medium posts in the chat, so people can go and take a look at that. And they all look, I got a feeling that'll be going to my read later queue.
Oh, thank you.
But if you have got anything to plug or anywhere you want to send anybody to?
I post sometimes on Medium. I am actually currently working for a Fox company, Mozilla. I am working on the there is a data science, not data science, a machine learning model, working on it. And I intend to do some more interviews on my channel, but I don't have anything concrete to plug here. So
I just thought I'd ask, because sometimes it's good to put people somewhere, isn't it? But Anirban, thank you so much. And to all you representatives out there who tuned in, thank you so much as well. We hope you learned something from this. I certainly did. And we'll see you next time for Old Code and New Tricks, which is in 2 weeks, I believe. I'm saying that very confidently now. Let me check my calendar. Maybe a little bit more than 2 weeks. I'll double check. I'll make sure it's on the Community Hub. But it's about 2 weeks, and we're going to have a fun time with that. So Anirban, thank you very much once again, and thank you guys for tuning in. Do please leave comments if you want to on the async as well. Thank you guys. Bye.
Thank you.